Father, we just thank you tonight for your goodness. God, we're so thankful for who you are, your character. God, that you don't leave us, you don't forsake us. You're just good.
Mountains are still being moved, strongholds still being loosed. God, we believe, yes, we can see, wonders are still what you do.
Say it again.
Mountains are still being moved, strongholds still being loosed. God, we believe, yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. 'Cause we are here for you, come and do what you do. We are here for you, come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you, come and do what you do. 'Cause we need a move, hopes up when you move. Heaven is coming.
How many came tonight needing to move? How many walked in the room tonight saying, God, I need you to move in a time like right now? Like, I need that move. I want to share just a few things with you, and then we're going to go back into worship. And I hope that you, as you've come in the door, that you feel safe, that you feel welcomed. You are wanted here. We believe at ELM that there is power in corporate worship, corporate prayer, and time together. And so to create an environment where we can come together is very important. And I think a lot of times people have questions of how do you feel about, or how is ELM going to embark on COVID-19 and mask mandates and things like that. And so I put a statement together. I'm going to read it to you. And there's a reason why. I'm really good at talking, but I can get off task, and then I won't say what I really need to say, and you guys don't want to hear me go rabbit trailing. So know this is from my heart. And I was thinking, I'm just going to read it. I remember towards the end of 2019, waiting anxiously for 2020. But wow, 2020 turned into quite a ride in its own way. I know that many of you are dealing with personal decisions about work, school, and socializing, and it often feels like as soon as we make a decision, something changes. Like, where is ELM meeting this week? Everything that's been going on has really challenged all of us to love well in our actions and our words, but through it all, we are our family. We are a family. All of us in this room tonight, as well as those who aren't with us physically, and just like family, we need to remember to show grace and love to each other. Forgive harsh words sometimes. Let things go. And sometimes just agree to disagree and not talk about the subject for a while. That's what loving well looks like in practice. Right now, people are in different places about COVID-19, and there are not a lot of clear answers. We do have directives from those in authority over us. Whether we agree with them or not, the Bible does direct us to be subject to the governing authorities when not in opposition to the Word of God. And the main directive is to give each other space. Space. Obviously, this means physical space. Physical distancing of 6 feet or more when not wearing a mask has been the word. We use physical distancing because I'm not a fan of social distancing. I'm not a fan of that word, social distancing. There is something about being physically spacing yourself with someone. So, obviously, this means physical space. Physical distancing of 6 feet or more when not wearing a mask, but it also means emotionally by showing grace to those who choose to respond differently than you do. Let's look at what the governor's mask mandate means. Just so you know, we contacted the State Department of Health to confirm. We spent almost an hour on the phone with them discussing what was the directive, what was meant, what was said, and how does it apply to us. How do we put it in practice in a church setting? First of all, it means that when you cannot socially distance inside, you need to wear a mask. Technically, we know that starts Monday, but we wanted to address it this weekend. So when you're entering and exiting the facility or when fellowshipping with each other, less than 6 feet apart, and you are not in a group of people that you normally hang with, they are not in your safe family zone, then you will need to wear a mask. I say that, and you need to know that we would not, this is not about rules and regulations and following you around, making sure that you have it on. But we need to understand what their words are. Second, it means that once you are seated physically, distanced from those you are not regularly in contact with outside of your church, you can remove your mask. You are not required to wear your mask through the entire service. However, you are more than welcome to do so. I want to make sure that you understand that. This is about space. This is about honoring each other's space. Third, it means that our worship team does not have to wear masks when leading worship, as they are distanced from each other and from you. The same applies to me or anybody else bringing the word. Those are the rules provided by the government. However, God asks more of us. He asks us to follow those rules, but also show love to one another. Some people will choose to wear their mask for the whole service and still ask for you to remain outside of their 6-foot bubble. That doesn't mean we need to ignore them. I think that's one of the greatest things that we have mistaken here, is that when someone is masked up or they clearly don't want us in their bubble, we now say, you're a leper and we won't talk to you. Please treat people with love and respect and know that we came here to fellowship. Some just need more distance. You can still greet each other and have conversation at the distance. They are choosing to be here with family, so let's remember to make them feel welcome. Some people will be fine with you coming into their bubble with your mask on. If you feel the same way, go in there for a fist bump and encouraging words. Some people are ready to get back to normal and are craving those hugs. If you are comfortable with that, get in there and hug it out. All you have to do is ask before entering their space. We may see people together without masks on who we know don't live in the same household, but we have a lot of people who work together and do life together and are already spending time together outside of church. Give them the benefit of the doubt. When it comes down to this, what it comes down to is this. What we always say, love each other well. Greet each other. Wear your mask when mingling and ask before entering someone's space. Respect each other's boundaries without condemnation or judgment. We're in this together and we refuse to let it drive us apart. I had a dear friend send me a text that after the governor said what he said, and they said, well, with the news of today, the outline is simple. If we social distance, no mask. If we can't social distance, put your mask on. The really good news is the Holy Spirit doesn't have any boundaries, and he's always free to move around, even if we can't. So I want to encourage you as we move forward. I use that word, the words move forward. The Lord's been speaking to me about moving forward. He's been reminding me of some prophetic words that were spoken over me a while back. A dear friend shared a dream that he had about me personally and just how I operate. And the Lord's been reminding me that in this season, the people around us need people who are united and love well, but aren't afraid to move some dirt, pave a path, and move forward. Not get caught up in all of the things that were and the things that might be and what ifs, but simply this. Do I feel loved? Do I feel safe? Do I feel welcomed? Do I feel respected? Do I feel honored? Then I have nothing to hold against someone else. And that's two-way street. We need to honor each other. Let's not get caught up in legalities or loopholes of the exacts, but can we just honor each other well when we're in the midst and not make assumptions, but also not hold judgment? Could we greet each other, be loving to each other, be friendly to each other, honor space? You know, I think the thing that's interesting about this is that for years, there have been people who will come into a church setting and they're a bit introverted and they don't like people in their personal bubble, and we go, and we're all over them and we're offended when they're like clamming up. But we're now in a season where people are even more uncertain. And so let's honor each other well and just say, just ask a question. I love it. Hey, are you good with hugs? And it's okay if someone says, no, I'm really not. But I'd love to talk to you from a distance. How are you doing? How are you doing? How are kids? All those questions. And so as we go back into worship, I would challenge you with this. Are you ready to move forward? Because I promise you the Lord is moving and he wants us to move forward with him. He's ready for us to go. So maybe if you would stand, let's go back into worship. Father, we just commit to you our hearts. We commit to not looking back. We commit to as you move, we move. And Father, we lay down our selfish pride. We lay down our thoughts that are incorrect. And we ask that you would fill our minds with your thoughts, with our ability to love the way you love. That we would greet each other with love and sincere respect and honor. That we would not get caught up in loopholes or legality of exactly what someone is doing, but Father, that we would be able to just walk in grace, that we would be able to have such mercy on their decisions. Father, that we would model how to love well, that we would model how to be in each other's lives and bring peace, bring unity, and bring hope to our community. Father, that as the enemy wants to keep us divided and tearing each other apart, that we would be a house of believers that would say we will not allow the enemy to always have the upper hand, that we will not allow the enemy to always create fear and disunity, but Father, that we would speak words of peace, that we would speak words of understanding and grace, because that's what you've called us to do. Jesus modeled it over and over again for us. He always spoke with grace and mercy. So we love you and we commit our hearts to you tonight. Father, we thank you. We thank you for a home, a place that we can come to tonight that is large enough that we can move around, that we can have lots of space and distance to honor each other. We love you and bless you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to see the joy I own, I'm not bringing my past me. Oh, I won't be shaking. Oh, I won't be shaking. 'Cause my feet doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My feet doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Creation knows the voice that spoke into the void, the breath that brought the dust to life and sang the stars to form. The darkness fears your voice that drove it back before. And though the night is long, I know your light will drive it back once more.
Glory.
We see you now in glory and power, beyond to the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing you now in glory and power, beyond to the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing you now in glory and power, beyond to the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing you now in glory and power, beyond to the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb who sits on the throne. Oh, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto the Lamb. 'Cause you are
about throwing down our own crowns before the Lord. God, we give you all glory tonight. We give you all honor tonight. It's all to you, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Yes, you are holy. You holy, you holy, Lord God Almighty. Yes, you are holy, you holy, you holy, Lord God Almighty. Oh, blessing and honor and glory.
deserve you. Deserve you. Who is more worthy than you? Who is more worthy than you? Thank you.
Yeah, tonight I believe that there's going to be a release of thankfulness that's going to break off some anxieties. Because there's something powerful about our thankfulness. There's something powerful about saying the words thank you. There's something powerful about that. And we begin to thank God for what we have. We begin to thank God for what He's doing, even when we don't see it. Things change. Our thankfulness changes the atmosphere we walk in. So tonight, I want to challenge you where you're at. Let's just begin to release thankfulness to the Lord. Father, we're so thankful for who you are. Father, we're so thankful for you. I can never say it enough. Thank you.
Once you have spoken, it is done. Once you have spoken, it is done. Once you have spoken, it is done.
Hey guys, you guys are amazing. I love the spirit that's in here right now. It's so overwhelming, really. This is a big, big house, isn't it? And of course, you know, when I was thinking about the music center, I hadn't even been in here yet. Who's already been in here before tonight? Good. I'm sure it's really rocking with the concert, but I just think our worship band is pretty amazing, and pretty cool, Nick, getting to play on the music stage. I mean, I'm pretty excited about speaking on it. Before we start, I have a little fun for us. You guys ready for a little fun? Okay. I have a music trivia for you. So Corey's gonna play a song for me, and if you know the words, sing along. From the college days back in the 90s. The louder the better. I don't know if you can turn it up. Because you need the beats, right?
I don't know where you lay your head or where you call your home. I don't know where you eat your meals or where you talk on the phone. I don't know if you got a cook, a butler, or a maid. I don't know if you got a yard with a hammock in the shade. Shelter, say a place to hide. I don't know if you live with friends and who you can confide. I don't know if you got a family, say a mom or dad. I don't know if you feel love at all, but I bet you wish you had. Come and go with me to my father's house. Come and go with me to my father's house. It's a big, big house with lots and lots of room. It's my father's house.
All right, fun's over. I love that song. I was thinking about that song for this place. And the Lord spoke to me and said, you need to claim that building as his house. This is his house. Well, we are in this facility. This space belongs to him. And I hope you feel, even with physical distancing and everything that's going on in the crazy world outside, that when you come here, you feel like you've been fed. You feel like you have a place to lay your head. You feel that you have family here. And that hasn't changed, even though our world is getting crazy and we're wearing the stress of that. This has not changed. God is an immutable God. He's unchangeable. He's unchangeable. And so tonight, I'm going to pray over you this prayer I always pray when I speak. From Ephesians 1. His word is unchanging. His word is unchanging. Its power to change lives throughout generations will continue. So let me pray this over you tonight. I pray that the God of our Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power to those who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and all authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the ones to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. Amen. And I think we could leave right now. I think we covered everything. You know, I come to speak when I prepare to speak. When Corey called me last week and said, we're going to have to cancel, and I'm like, oh gosh, thank you, Lord. Because as much as the Lord had been speaking to me, like, he just kept saying more and more and more, and I was having trouble fitting all the pieces together. And so, you know, the Lord knew ahead of time that I would need time. He was not surprised by that cancel. He was not surprised by that at all. Did not shock him. Did not bother him. When I was thinking about this big, big house tonight, I thought how inadequate I felt to speak from this stage. Not just because it's a large house. I've spoken at some bigger places, maybe not this big, but just because it just felt like a lot of pressure. It just felt like a lot of pressure to do something special in this place. And of course, then, you know, I started remembering that when I was in college, I had another situation with a big, big house. Actually, it was right after college. I was working in Fisher's at a doctor's office as a medical assistant, and there was a nurse practitioner, and she was going on vacation, and she asked if I would house sit her house. Well, her husband is a very wealthy doctor, and she's a nurse practitioner in Indianapolis. And so I was like, sure, yeah, that's fine. Just let me know your address, and, you know, we'll meet up. And so I went over to her house for her to show me everything, and her house was like a mansion. And I'm like, I felt so intimidated, like 4-car garage, security system, like a Bose, I don't even know how to say it because I'm not that fancy, radio station, you know, it was like a whole stereo system. It had no buttons on it, and I'm like, I don't even know how to work this thing, right? It was just humongous. The house was so big, I was just, like, afraid to be there. I was really intimidated I was going to mess something up. You know, I grew up, just full disclosure, in a single-wide trailer just north of Helmsburg. So I was a little out of my comfort zone. And I thought in my head, I thought to myself, if they just knew where I was from, they wouldn't trust me. You know, even though my character is good, my past probably would hold them up from letting me house at their house. Well, it was so bad in this house. I was so afraid of messing something up. I don't know how many times the security system, like, they call you because I messed the code up or something. It was nerve-wracking. And you know what? Although I had full run of the house, I actually slept on the couch in their family room off the kitchen because I felt so out of my comfort zone. And I say all that to say this, is that if you just knew me, I think when we get up here to worship, to lead worship, to pastor, to speak, I think in our hearts, a lot of us say, if you just knew how inadequate I am to bring this word to you, but how humbled I am that God would choose me. And I hope I can be a good steward of that for you tonight. And the only reason I'm here to speak is because God gave me something for you. I didn't just fill a slot. I've been listening to the Lord. And so tonight, I want to share with you some things that God, when we doubt ourselves, the things that God wants to do to restore our confidence and empower us for his kingdom. And we're going to be in Exodus. We're going to go visit Moses for a while. So Exodus at the very beginning, Exodus 1. And I'm actually going to start reading in Acts. There's a summary of the whole Exodus story in Acts 7, 22, I believe, or actually maybe before that. The main section that I was going to talk about is 22, but maybe at the beginning of chapter 7. So if you want to go to Acts 7, you can follow along. I think I have the NIV version. But I love all versions of the Bible, so who knows what's on my sheet. So if it didn't follow yours, I'm sorry. I'm going to read a little bit of the story. I'm going to make some comments as we go. It's a little bit long, but I hope to engage you. And if at any point you want to shout out an answer, because I'm like a classical teacher by trade. So if I ask you a deep question, like, what do you think about that? I really do expect an answer. Okay. And even though this is big, I think I could hear you. So, all right. So the glory of God appeared to our father Abraham while he was still in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran. Leave your country and your people, God said, and go to the land that I will show you. So he left the land of Chaldeans and settled in Haran after the death of his father. God sent him to this land where you're now living. He gave him no inheritance, not even enough ground to set his foot on, but God promised him that he and his descendants after him would possess the land, even though at that time Abraham had no child. So that's a big promise, right? That's a big promise from God. It's not in the natural. Abraham's not going, oh yeah, that's so doable, God. So God spoke to him in this way for 400 years. He said, your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and mistreated, but I will punish the nations they serve as slaves. God said, and afterward, they will come out of that country and worship me in this place. As the time drew near for God to fulfill his promise to Abraham, the number of our people in Egypt had greatly increased. Then a new king who to whom Joseph meant nothing, because remember, Joseph had brought the people in to save them from the famine. He had been taken there as a slave, and God had built him up into like second in command of the country. And then he was able to bring his brothers and their families to save them from the famine. It says he dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our ancestors by forcing them to throw out their newborn babies so that they would die. So what had happened is many years had gone by between Joseph had favor with the Pharaoh, and now so many years have gone by that they've forgotten the favor. And so now we're going to go to Exodus 8. This is where I want the details of the story. So I don't want an overview. I want a detail. This is when the new king, to whom Joseph meant nothing, came to power in Egypt, and he said, look, he said to his people, the Israelites, they become far too numerous for us. Come, we must deal with them shrewdly so that they will become even more numerous. And if war breaks out, we'll join our enemies and fight us and leave the country. So this is what they did. They put slave masters over them to oppress them with their forced labor. And they built Pithom and Ramses as store cities for Pharaoh. So that's some of the work that the Israelites did. They built those cities for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. And so the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites, and they worked them ruthlessly. They made their lives bitter with harsh labor in brick and mortar and with all kinds of work in the fields. In their harsh labor, the Egyptians worked with them ruthlessly. Do you see how that was repeated? Anytime a scripture is repeated like that, it's like for emphasis, no, it was really bad is what they're saying. It was really bad. And so back to Acts 7, at the time that Moses was born, he was no ordinary child. He was no ordinary child. For 3 months, he was cared for by his actual family. And then he was placed outside. We know the story. He was placed into the Nile River because they had been ordered to throw the babies in the river. And his mother waited as long as she could. And then she made a little basket, sent his sister to watch over him. We all know this from VBS. Probably some of you could tell this story by heart, right? And then what happened is as the Pharaoh's daughters came down to the water to bathe, she saw the basket, had her servants get the basket, and was like, oh, what is this? Oh, it's a child. Oh, my goodness. And our little mother's hearts, we go, oh, my gosh, the baby's in the water, right? We're scared for Moses and for the baby. And this is the miraculous thing that God did to save Moses and to put him in the right place where he needed to be. And so his sister actually came out and said, oh, would you like me to get a nurse for him? And she's like, oh, yes, that would be wonderful. And so it ends up happening, which only God can do these things, right, is that he was actually raised for his formative years with his own mother and then was taken to Pharaoh's daughter to be her adopted son. So really the grandson of Pharaoh, right? So he had both. He had both an understanding, because the Bible scholars believe that that his parents actually taught him about his actual people and their God, right? And so because he had that, and in addition, he was raised in Pharaoh's house, the word says that he was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and action. So he had this unique niche. But also, this is what I imagine, if you could just go here with me for a minute. I feel so bad for Moses in some ways, because I imagine Moses in his later years having like an emotional, psychological breakdown of sorts. Because I imagine him like a little cartoon. Thad will appreciate this. He loves cartoons. Laying on the psychologist's couch or the psychiatrist's couch. And then that psychiatrist is saying, "Tell me about your father." And he's like, "Okay, which one?" Right? Because he was raised with his natural father for some of his years. He was named as Pharaoh as his kind of father authority figure. And then later years, he comes to encounter God the Father, right? And so I feel so bad for Moses, because I just see all of this turmoil and this twisting and this kind of, who am I kind of thing going on for him. When he was 40 years old, he decided that he would visit his own people, the Israelites. And so he went out and he saw them being mistreated by the Egyptian slave masters. And he went to defend and avenge the one that was being beaten by the Egyptian slave master, and he actually ended up killing him, right? He ended up killing him, and it was out of his sense of justice. Like, that is not okay. This is not okay. Here he is, raised in Pharaoh's house, so he's on this side where I'm a prince of Egypt, right? I have position, I have clout, you know, people laugh at my jokes. That's what I imagine, right? Like, in the cartoon version, like, he's like handsome and, you know, he has everything going for him. And then on this other side, he feels torn because these people who are in slavery are his people. And I'm sure he felt like, oh, I should be able to do something about that with my authority. But I gotta be under Pharaoh, and Pharaoh's really worried about these guys taking over or leaving us with no laborers. And so he was torn. But in this situation, he let his sense of justice and anger get the best of him, and he actually killed the slave master and buried him in the sand, the word says. And then the next day, he came upon two Israelites who were fighting, and he's like, "Brother, men, you're brothers. Why do you want to hurt each other?" And the men who were mistreating each other said to him, "Who made you the ruler, right, and the judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me like you killed the slave master?" And all of a sudden, Moses knew, oh, that's not a secret. People know. And if people know, right, then Pharaoh's going to know. He's going to know that I'm opposing his rule, his authority in the country with what he wants to do. And in addition to that, here's Moses again. He's on one side of the fence as a prince of Egypt, and he's on the other side of the fence as an actual Hebrew, and then here he is being actually, like, condemned from his own people. Well, who makes you the judge of us, right? You're not one of us. He's, like, in this in-between land, and he doesn't know who he is yet. But, so he runs away because he's afraid for his life. He has revealed to Pharaoh that he is potentially an enemy, because he does not want the same thing that Pharaoh wants. So instead of, you know, it's interesting to me. Don't you ever wonder why he didn't go and like, talk to Pharaoh first before he, fled the country? Like, do you think he maybe would go and, like, make excuses for himself or something? I feel like maybe he should. Like, that might be a better plan, but he didn't. And I don't know why, but I'm really curious to know why. I don't know if it's because, do you imagine that Pharaoh is a very harsh ruler? If he's that cruel to the Hebrews, I feel like that is probably the reason, and there was probably no compassion in his heart for what Moses had done. So he goes to Midian. The Bible scholars believe that Midian they were actually kind of like cousins, like the Midianites were kind of cousins to the Israelites. Apparently, Abraham was married a second after Sarah, and his wife and him had more children. And the Midianites were descendants from their fourth child, is what I read. So he goes to Midian, and he sits beside a well. Some young ladies come to water their sheep. And along comes a kind of a band of other shepherds. And they're like, hey, get out of here. We want to water our sheep. You're in our way. And he actually stands up for them, drives the other shepherds away, and helps the ladies water their sheep. And because of that move, we get another glimpse of who Moses is meant to be. He almost can't help himself from being a deliverer, being a savior, being a helper. He almost just can't help it. Even though he's lost everything, he's just sitting beside the well, just having fled for his life from Egypt. And we just get another glimpse. He just can't help himself. You know, when I look back over my life, and you probably can do the same thing. There were moments before I knew what God's purpose was for me when he gave me a glimpse of it, right? And you young people, you keep an eye out for that, because you can start connecting those dots of what the Lord is doing in your life, and you might begin to piece together some things or a purpose that he has for you, something specific. But I can do that. Anyone else can do that? I can kind of look back now and go, oh, God was preparing this and this and this, and I didn't even know it. And I love that about God. He knows you. He knows how to prepare you as well. And so when he moves and does those things, pay attention. Write those things down. So many times people had given me like a word or something like that, and I knew it was so important to me, and I didn't write it down. But then I learned my lesson. I started writing everything down, and there are still some promises that God has made to me that have not come to pass yet. And I can't wait to see him do it. It gives me hope for the future. I'm still here. God's not fulfilled that promise yet. Guess what? I'm not going anywhere. God has spoken. He has things to do yet. And that makes me so, so excited to see what he is going to do. It puts things in perspective in a very clear way. All right, so here's the story we all know of. Who knows the story of Moses in the burning bush? Right, Kendra, I'll bet you could give it to me verbatim and teach us probably better even. But the burning bush story is where Moses, it's his aha moment with God, right? Okay, so in the Bible, 40 years is meant to be like a generation number. It's also meant to be a trial number. So like, you know, Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days. Moses and the Israelites end up traveling through the desert wilderness before the promised land for 40 years, right? There's a lot of examples. So when he's 40 is when he went when he fled Egypt, all right? And now it's 40 more years have passed. So he is now, he's a shepherd with his father-in-law, Jethro, who was the father of one of the daughters that he helped at the well. And he's lived there for 40 years. Gives the impression that he's pretty content in his job. He's a shepherd. You know, he gets to be outside for his work. How many like outside work? I do. I hate feeling trapped in a building, right? So he seems pretty happy. He's got a couple kids. His father-in-law was a priest of the Midianites. So he's kind of godly and wise and helpful and has taken him in and shown him kindness. So he's got it going pretty good. He's a shepherd, and they're out near Mount Horeb, the mountain of God is what they call it, when all of a sudden he notices the burning bush. And, you know, that wasn't uncommon in that time or in that area. They would have bushes that would catch on fire because of the heat, but they wouldn't stay on fire, right? So he's like, ooh, why is this thing not burning up? Let me go check this out. And as he draws close to the bush, it says that the Lord saw him, that he'd gone over to look, and God told him, from within the bush, Moses, Moses, he called his name. You know what Moses did? Immediately said, here I am. Okay, imagine you're Moses for a minute. Just imagine you're Moses checking out this burning bush, and you hear a voice coming out of it. And it says your name. Like, I know we've told this story a lot of times, but the fact that God was encountering him and calling him by, I would love to hear the Lord call my name. Would you not love that? Wendy, right? I mean, you're in the middle. I'm picking on you guys because you're right there in the middle. And you would just, and your my response would be, Michelle's would be terror. I could guarantee that. I would love to be there to see that, actually. But those are the best times of my life, was when Michelle's been scared. But his immediate response is, here I am. Here I am. And then I hope that I know that it's possible. Moses did it. I want to be ready to say, here I am, Lord. Here I am. At the minute he calls me, I'm aware. I'm up. What do you need, Lord? I'm right here. I'm ready to go. Right? But God said to him, he says, don't come any closer. Take off your sandals, for this place where you are standing is holy ground. And when I read that, I've read that a quadrillion times probably. But you know what? I love ELM. I love our worship. You know why I love our worship? It's holy. There's a presence in our worship where God actually meets with us, just like he did here with Moses. And I feel like if we had a reverence when we came here, or anywhere we meet, that this was holy ground, get ready for something good, I feel like that's who we are. I feel like that's what God intends us to be. And the worship ushers in his presence, and we just get to be here to receive. And I'm so blessed by our worship, so blessed. There is a lot of work that goes into worship, and it is worth every bit of it. And we thank you guys for everything that you do to make that happen. It is a blessing that we could not get everywhere. We could not get anywhere but here. And so he said then to Moses, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, and of the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And at this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Now, he's been pretty bold with God so far, but it's a reverence, I believe. I believe he was just reverent. He's like, oh, it is God. God, the one I have heard about, the one of my father's fathers, right? And the Lord said, I have seen the misery of my people in Egypt. One version said, I have come down and visited them, and I have seen. Do you love that idea that wherever I am suffering and in pain, that the Lord probably has visited me there and seen me? There are studies that are done. Vel and I visited a college in Michigan. And there, if we were to pick a college based upon solely their president's speech, it would have been Hope College. He was a fantastic speaker. And what he spoke about was that there are studies that are done that show that people need to feel as though they are known and seen. Known and seen. And when he said that truth hit me so deeply. It's true. That's what we come to church for that. That's why social distancing is hard, right? We want to be known and seen. My kids struggle when we've not been around people for a while because they don't feel known or seen or understood. It's important to us as human beings. God knows that. And he says right here, and this is not the version, but the other version that I read, I don't know, New King James maybe, says, I have visited and I have seen. Thank you for that. Thank you, Lord, that you visit us and see us in our pain. And he said this, I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I'm concerned about their suffering. So I come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and it is the land of all of these ites. And then again, he repeats this. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now I'm going to send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. And again, he repeated that he'd heard the cry of his people. Anytime in Scripture that things are repeated close together, it's for emphasis. It's for emphasis. If you didn't get it before, I'm a God who hears your cries. I am a God who hears your cries. And here's the question I ask myself, but why now, Lord? Why just now, after all of these years, was he ready to move? And here's what I think the Lord revealed to me. They weren't ready for him to move yet. You know, we have to kind of cooperate. The leadership has to be in place for these moves of God, right? These things have to happen. And so God is a God of compassion. He's a God who sees us and who knows us and who wants to be there with us in our suffering and wants to deliver us from that. So Moses said to God, but who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Would that have been your response? I mean, he was a former prince of Egypt, and he still had that response. I would feel like he kind of would have a little bit more like feelings of grandiose, like, yes, I shall, Lord. I will go right after that and get that done for you. Because he's a prince. He's walked under he's been royalty, essentially, right? So I would think he would think he could possibly do that. But he's insecure, right? Who am I? Who am I to do that? Also, I'm pretty sure he's thinking back to that instance with the people where they're like, who makes you our judge, right? Thinking, oh, they're not really going to receive me. And so the Lord says this. This is his answer. Okay, so this is the question that he asked. Who am I to go do that work for you, Lord? And this is the answer. I will be with you. Isn't that the answer to just about everything? Who am I, Lord, to do that? Or who am I to do that? Right? And really, the answer is pretty simple. Because I'll be with you. If I called you to it, I will prepare you for it. I'll resource it. I'll make it happen. Because that's all that matters, is that I am in it. I am in it with you. And so he says, and I believe that Moses really actually had a failure kind of complex. Like, he really thought potentially he would fail this mission. But God's answer was, all you need is my presence. That's all you really need. And so his next question, Moses' next question was, suppose I go to the Israelites and I say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me. And they ask me, well, what is his name? Then what should I tell them? What do you think he asked that question? Really, I want to answer. Why would he say that? Why would he care the name of God? I mean, what would it matter? Kendra, you're so good. Yes. Whose authority am I doing this work by, right? And do I have the authority to do this work, right? Who, just exactly who are you? And now in Egypt, think about Egypt too. They served many false gods. So like that culture was just steeped in this god for this, and this god for this, and this god for this. So it was really important to know, okay, what god am I doing this work for? And make sure I got this right. Now you said it was this guy, but I don't know if he's like question, like, is this a trick question from Moses to God? I don't know. But God said this. He said, I am who I am, all capitals, which is a big deal. And this is what you're to say to the Israelites. The I am has sent me to you, right? I am, I have some notes about I am, but I am meant to them the same as the father of God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That was his name. And the scripture actually says, this is my name forever, the name that you shall call me from generation to generation. That actually I am actually meant more to them. And it says that he actually, that I am who I am actually meant more. And it meant that he was the unchanging, immutable God, right? It meant that he would be who he is. He's basically, there's no other way to describe me except I will be who I am, essentially. And so, and Moses knew what that meant from his learning growing up from his parents. He knew that the significance of that was that, okay, this is the real deal. All right, and so then they go on and say, okay, what you need to do, go to the elders and tell them that I'm going to deliver them, and the elders will listen to you, is what God says. And I think that's important. He did a lot of, like, basic steps for Moses in these instructions. They will listen to you. Why would Moses need to know that? Yeah, his confidence. He needed to be reassured that there was going to happen, that it would be okay. Also, they will listen to you now, right? They're ready to listen to you, which is important. And so So God said, I will stretch out my hand and I will strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. He knew the king wouldn't, Pharaoh wouldn't let him go first. He knew he'd have to do some wonders first. And then he would let him go. And then he said this. This is so cool to me, too. If you're taking notes, you're going to want to write this down. In verse 21, he says this. Get this. This is kind of one of those moments where you go, oh, you're just showing off, God. That's really cool. He says, and I will make the Egyptians favorably disposed toward the people, so that when you leave, you will not go empty-handed. Every woman is to ask her neighbor. Get this, ladies. Think about this. Every woman is to ask her neighbor and any woman living in the house for articles of silver, gold, and clothing, which you'll put on your sons and daughters, and so you will plunder the Egyptians. They're leaving, and you're just going to go, poor slave woman, and ask the neighbor, could I have some gold and silver, please? And they are going to give it to you. That's just God showing off, don't you think? Really, that's just God showing off. He's just like, and I'll give you everything you need. And we'll take it from the Egyptians who've really treated you bad. That's amazing to me. What? Just showing off. Okay, so then Moses is getting back to his, well, I'm not sure they're going to believe me, God. I'm just not sure they're going to believe me. And they might even say to me, God didn't really appear to you. He may not have really appeared to you. And so God actually gives Moses some signs and wonders to work before them. He actually has him throw his rod on the ground and it becomes a snake, and then pick it back up, turns back into a rod. He has him put his hand in his coat and it comes out leprous, and he puts it back in and it comes back healed. And then he says, well, if that doesn't work, the first two don't work, then get some water from the Nile and I want you to, and it'll turn into blood. So they did that. And I was like, okay. Okay, so not only does he want to provide them with favor, give them material goods, plundered from the Egyptians, but now he's also prepared to show off the power of his God, right, for Moses to feel confident in going to do this work for the Lord. Then Moses takes it a step farther, and he says, well, you know, Lord, I'm not that eloquent of a speaker, and I've never been, and I just don't know if maybe someone else would be better. Please send someone else, is what he said. And the Lord was like, he was a little upset with Moses, and then he said, you know what? How about Aaron? In fact, he's on the way. Your brother Aaron is actually on the way to meet you right now. He'll be really happy to do this job with you. And there you go. You'll open your mouth and you'll be like God to him. He'll receive the words from you and then he'll pass it on to the people. It's going to work out great, right? So God has done all of these things to prepare Moses to feel confident to do the work that he's called him to do, which he prepared for him to do a long time ago and was bringing him to this point, right? Because it said, at the beginning of what we read, in the fullness of time, right? Essentially, in the fullness of time, it was time for God to fulfill his promises. Now, we have a God. This is the God we serve. He is the God who does not forget his promises. He is a God who will come back to those promises, and he's a God who's still preparing you for some promises to be fulfilled. You might be at any one of those stages, but let me tell you this. When you get to the stage where he shows up and says, let's do it now, and you start making excuses, he'll come up with every answer to your problems. Every answer. Corey can probably preach on that, because ELM, God just keeps showing up, right? Well, that's not going to work. Well, that's not going to work. And in the worst of circumstances, in a pandemic of all things, right, we have a startup church trying to find a facility, trying to social distance, and the Lord keeps breaking open doors for us. Praise God for that. We're so grateful for that. And it shows me that he's not done, and he's going to fulfill those promises to us. He's going to fulfill those promises to us. He has destined, this is not in my notes, he has destined this place to be a resting place for his Holy Spirit, where people come and get filled out and go back out. That's what he's destined this region to be. That's the thing that he wants us to be involved in, right? We have the potential, and Belle and I walked in here tonight, and it was our first night, and I'm like, oh my goodness, this feels like a big church. Right? Yes. Who's been to a big church lately? I mean, this feels like a big church. I'm not going to lie to you. We went to the bathroom. I'm like, this feels like a big church in the bathroom. I mean, I know that's just ridiculous, but when God moves, he can do some pretty powerful things that we did not think could possibly happen. And, you know, if we have to do a little social distancing at first to get this facility, praise God for that. I'll just put on that mask all day long, right? Right. You know what I see when I look out here at this room? I see it filled. In another year and a half, I see it filled with people worshiping the Lord, coming and getting filled up to go back out. That's what I see. I feel like God's placed that burden on a lot of our hearts, that we see the potential here in this place. And it's not an accident. It's not like coincidence that we're having the same vision. It's that the Lord has led us to this place. And I pray that when he says, Corey, or Wendy, or Adam, or whoever he calls to do whatever he needs to do here, that you say, here I am, Lord. I'm planning on saying it. Whatever you want me to do, God, I'm on board. I just want to see what you're going to do. I just want to see you move in a way that I've never seen before. I believe you for everything that you've promised us, every single thing. And I believe that he has the answer to every one of our excuses. So if you're in the business of making excuses, go ahead and make those excuses, and the Lord will meet you right there. So you might as well just say yes. In fact, the reason I'm up here tonight is because Gene told me the next thing that the Lord told me to do, I had to say yes. I'm like, well, Gene told me, I guess I have to do it. Even stressed and unprepared, I literally finished this message at 5:00 tonight. I had 2 weeks, I had an extra week to prepare. So, okay, I'm gonna all round up. That's way off my notes. Okay, all right, so Moses, this is the best part. I know you guys, like, we've heard the whole story, Michelle, and you're telling us the whole story, but I'm giving you some better information than you've ever thought of before, right? Like, I'm really breaking it open for you. Just appease me a little bit, it's okay. Okay, so Moses returns to Egypt. First of all, he goes back to Jethro, his father, and gets permission to leave, his father-in-law. He wants to say, and he doesn't really tell him what he's up to. I kind of don't think I would either. By the way, father-in-law, I'm going to go back to Egypt and get my people out of slavery. All 600,000 men and the women and children, right? No big deal. I mean, that's what God told me to do. And he didn't really tell Jethro what he was doing. He's like, sure, go ahead. He just said, I'm going to go check and see if my family is still alive, right? And so he lets him go. But before he goes, the Lord actually appears to him again. And I think this is so cool because in Moses' heart, I believe he was probably still worried for his well-being going back to Egypt because at that time, the Pharaoh that was in power who wanted to kill him was still there. But the Lord actually came to him and said, oh, by the way, go ahead and go back to Egypt now because everyone who wanted you dead, they're gone, right? They're already gone. So you can go ahead and go. It's like the Lord just like, oh, you're worried about that too? Oh, let me reassure you, it's going to be okay. All right, and this is where the message takes off. I mean, it was good now, but before now, but it's getting better. This is where it gets really bad. All right, so you know how we always call God our Heavenly Father, right? Our Heavenly Father, right? I love that. Do you guys imagine yourself sitting on his lap sometimes and like you're so small and he's so powerful and big and so kind and he has the eyes of Ron Eddins because Ron has the eyes of Jesus, right? So just so compassionate and loving, and we call him our Heavenly Father, and I love to identify with God that way. But here in Scripture, we find the first place where he calls himself the father of his people. And I didn't know that was there. It's beautiful. He says this. He says, when you return to Egypt, he tells him, kind of like recaps the whole thing again, but he kind of ups the ante just a little bit with Moses. He says, I want you to go and perform all those wonders for Pharaoh, right, that I've given you to do. And then I'm going to harden his heart so he won't let the people go. And then I want you to say to Pharaoh, I want you to say to him this. This is what the Lord says. Ooh, get ready. Israel is my firstborn son, and I told you, let my son go so he may worship me. My firstborn son. Firstborn sons in that time and day received the entire inheritance for the family, right? By extension of Jesus Christ and the work that he did at the cross, we too are heirs with him to the throne of God, right? We are his firstborn sons. You know what's so awesome about God? You know, we're all firstborns. We all get all the blessing, all of it. We don't have to split it amongst like however many Christians there are in the world, right? When the rapture, we don't have to split it up. God is so God that he can give all of us everything. All of us, everything that he has for us. And you know what? The other thing it speaks to me is this. When God's people are in bondage, they can't bring glory to him through their worship. Right? I want them to be out of Egypt. I want them delivered from slavery because when they're in bondage, they can't fully glorify my name. Same is true for us. Same is true for us. That's why God cares so much about our little hang-ups, about those little things that we need to let God into and let him get healed, get us healed on those things. He cares so much because it means so much to him. He knows how he wants to bless you. He knows the work he wants to do through you if you would just let him in to heal those things. To heal those things. So when God came to Moses, this is what he helped Moses do in all of that discussion and all that story. When God calls us too up out of slavery, these are the things he has to reset in us. Right? When we're in slavery, like Moses or the people, we cannot, and it's not a wonder that God chose Moses to lead the people up out of slavery, because God could not have chosen a slave who had a slave's mindset to lead the people out, right? He doesn't even know that's a possibility with a slave's mindset, right? He's in so much bondage in the here and now and just having to, you know, kind of how we feel on a work Monday, right? Got to get it done. Got to get it done. I don't know if there's any God in it or any Holy Spirit, but I just got to get the work done, right? Sometimes we just feel that way. That's a slave's mindset where we don't see God at work in greater things all the time, right? But when God calls us up out of slavery, he needs to reset who we are. He needs to reset who we are so he can do what he needs to do. He needs to reset our identity in him. We've got to come up out of a slave mindset and come into a royalty mindset, right? We are daughters and sons of the king, just like Moses. Moses had that still in him, right? He still understood authority and power and rule and reign. He didn't like the cruelty that he saw in Pharaoh, but he was raised in a house of royalty. And so when he came into contact with God and said, I want you to go do these things, even though he made all those excuses, he really, at one point he said, he was asking another question, but he said, well, when I go, he didn't exclude going at all. He said, when I go, what do I do about this, God? Right? He was willing to go. That's a royalty mindset, that God has set you up for great things. Great things. This crowd tonight, it may be small, but it is mighty. He has set you up for good and powerful things. And so when he resets our identity, he assures us that we're serving the right God. He says, I am who I am. I'm unchangeable. You can count on me. I'm faithful. And you know what, friends? It matters who we serve, doesn't it? Does it matter who we serve? It matters who we serve. If we don't serve the right God, we're not having the right outcome. We serve the God of self, and we wonder why we're not fulfilled. Well, because you can't fulfill yourself, right? We just can't. It's not how God made us. We need him to be fulfilled. It matters who we serve. He resets our identity when he calls himself our Father, right? That we are firstborn heirs. We don't have to split it with anyone. I want you to know that tonight. If you came in the room and you think, well, everybody else has it better than me, and everybody else is getting some spiritual gifts and doing some God things, and I'm that's just keeping me from getting mine. Where's mine, Lord? You know, if you have a heart for God and you want to do something for him, he will bring it to you. You just ask him for it. I guarantee you, his heart is to love you and fill you and give you purpose beyond anything you've ever, ever imagined. So he resets our identity. He lets us know that we are, he is our Father. This, and throughout the, I read an article, I way over research when I speak, way, that's why it takes me forever. I read an article, a study that a guy had done, he put together, and it was so fascinating. I actually read it again today, it was really good. Highlighted and everything, because I'm a very big nerd about that. But it was speaking to me so much, and so we started with this verse in the story here about when God first said, this is my firstborn son, I am the Father of Israel, when he first said that. And he and the guy had done a study, and he'd picked up every other place in Scripture where God alluded to a fatherly characteristic in himself. And this is the combined. I won't read every scripture to you unless you would like me to. No, is that a no? Okay, all right. So, this is what he says about himself as he describes himself as the father figure throughout all of the Old Testament. This doesn't even include the New Testament. Oh my goodness. If you want the New Testament, what you need to go home and do is research who I am in Christ. It will blow your mind. And that's the New Testament. This is just the Old Testament. So just hold on to your seat. Are you ready? He is the Father of the nation and every individual in the nation. He is their creator and their caretaker. And he formed and shaped them, and he disciples them. And he disciplines them, and he brings them up, and he loves them, and he created them for a purpose. He has an inheritance for them. He saves them. He redeems them. He provides rest and guidance, is compassionate and kind, loving and merciful, tender and caring, longs for his children, heals his children, likes them. He likes you. I think that's maybe it's a tiny little phrase here, but sometimes that's the thing we don't think God does. He doesn't like me. Oh, yes, he does. Oh, yes, he does. He delights in them. He treasures his people. That is just the Old Testament. That is the God that we serve. If you didn't know that when you came in tonight, that's who you serve. That is who you serve. That's the kind of father he is to his people. The next thing he resets in our identity is that we truly are sons and daughters. Ephesians 1:5 says he destined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself according to the kind intention of his will. The kind intention of his will. If you ever doubted that he had kind intentions towards you as a son and daughter, it's right here in the word. And another version of this says his good pleasure. It's his good pleasure to call you a son or a daughter. Romans 8:14 says, well, maybe 8:14 through 17, somewhere in there, says, for you have not received a spirit of slavery that leads you to fear again. Instead, you have received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. Our spirits cry out, Abba, Father, because of that. We don't have a spirit of slavery. We are adopted. We have received the spirit of adoption, and we get to cry out, Abba, Father. When I crawl up into God's lap in my vision with the Lord, that I, Abba, Father, I need you. Comfort me. Protect me. Show me who I am in you. Abba, Father. The next thing he resets in us, when we come up out of that slavery mindset, is that he is our protection. He is our protection. His presence will go with us. Later on, as they're getting ready to cross the Red Sea, and they've already gone out of Egypt, and then Pharaoh gets his mind back and is like, oh my gosh, what have I done? I gotta go get those people. I'm not gonna have anything left. Like, they are my resource. And he heads after them. This stood out to me. Listen, when you come out from under the authority of a cruel, evil enemy, and you head into the promise of a good heavenly father, you just better be ready to be chased down. And I'm sorry that that's true, but don't be surprised when it happens. Also, don't be surprised when God intervenes. This is what he did. He said later, he rescues them as they're getting ready to cross because the Egyptians are heading towards them, and the people are panicking. They're panicking. And so God actually moves his presence. So there was the pillar of cloud, that was the presence of the Lord, actually moved that, and the angel of the Lord, both were there, moved from the front of the people group to the back, right? He sets the cloud up. This is so God. He sets the cloud up so that one side is nighttime and one side is daylight. And then he has Moses hold his, stretch out his hand over the sea, and this wind blows for like, I don't know, it was like a day or 24 hour overnight. And it dries, it splits up the water, so when we used to do this for VBS, like, you know, in my head, I'm like, well, it splits the water. That's what we think of, right? Splits the water. But the mud would have been impossible to walk through in the riverbed, right? It would have been impossible, or the seabed or whatever. And so he actually blew wind to dry it all up. So he held back the Egyptians with his presence, with his holy presence, while he prepared the way for them to escape their enemy, right? And the people were panicked. And Moses was like, guys, settle down here. You know, the Lord, he can do his thing. And he did. He did his thing. And Moses, later on, when they're out in the wilderness, at one point he actually refuses to move on unless God's presence would go with them. You know why? Because that moment, and a lot of others, where God's presence was their protection. God's presence is our protection. When you walk into this place and you are filled up with the presence of the Lord, you walk out of here protected. You just do. The other thing that he resets when we come up out of that slave mindset to a princely royal mindset is that he's our provision. He meets our needs. Just as he gave Moses those signs to do, to prove, to help him get free, he is our provision. He also sent food for them in the wilderness. He sent he allowed them to have those clothes that they took from their neighbors. They plundered from the neighbors. And he brought water out of rocks. All of those things he provided. If God called them to do it, so he provided what was necessary for it. So Moses, he had been raised in a king's house, right? And that slave mindset would not have allowed him to do what God had called him to do. And as a prince of Egypt, he understood authority. I think that's the bottom line right here. He understood authority, both in the natural. He understood it in the natural, so that when he encountered that authority in the spiritual with God, he could receive it pretty easily. He knew about authority. You know, the world works on authority. The spiritual world works on authority. Right? Whether you know it or not, you're under someone's authority right now. Right now. And I'm not talking about our governments. I'm talking about either our enemy, yourself, or God. Right? There's really only three choices. God is calling us out of our slavery mindset. He's calling us out of bondage. You know, we have to realign ourselves with his true character and come under his loving authority. Moses knew authority, the authority of Pharaoh, but he had to learn the compassionate authority of God. And you know, even that word authority, actually this is the first word that God gave me for this message. He said to me, some people will flinch and turn off their mind when you say the word authority because they've been abused. Authority has been so misused in the church, it's ridiculous. It's one of Satan's greatest tools in the church. Some of you, I'm one of them. Some of us have been so abused with authority. This is not the authority that I'm talking about. I'm talking about we have to realign ourselves. That authority, God's authority, is meant to be kind, compassionate, loving, protective, and providing. That's what real authority is, right? It's putting yourself under the loving care of someone else. So they came out, and they headed towards the promised land, right? And really, you know, they kind of had two ways to go there with heart issues. They could take a little detour called your own authority, and this is what the Israelites chose to do. They started grumbling. They still had their slave mindset. They started grumbling and complaining. They did not reset their identity as children of a loving God. Loving and powerful God. And they questioned whether he was really going to protect them or really going to provide for them. They did. And so, and their attitude was pretty bad. And let me just give you an example here. This is pretty good. Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? I feel like I've heard some of that tone before. When things get tough, right? When things get hard, we tend to want to grumble. We tend to want to be sarcastic. And this is what they said, what have you done to us by bringing us up out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians? It would be better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert. To die in the desert. And this is what God said. Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance of the Lord. The Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord you fight will fight for you. You only need to be still. You only need to be still. He's going to do the fighting. Quit your grumbling and complaining. All you got to do is stand there and watch him work. So many times I wish someone would have said that to me in a hard time when I just really wanted to do something to fix it. And I should have just been on my knees praying and asking God to do his thing. That's some wisdom right there. Just be quiet, Michelle. Just be quiet and let God do his thing. My job is to pray for his will. And then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites, Corey, to move on. Tell them to move on. Yes, why are we sitting here grumbling and complaining? We got some things to do. We got some places to go. As my dad would say, we got places to go, people to see, things to do. Right? We do. We have some things to do. The Lord wants us to move on. Just get out of that grumbling mindset. Just move on. Let's see what he will do. The second choice is the choice that happens when you follow the Lord, like Moses did. Moses was a great leader, and he kept trying to talk those Israelites into remembering what God had done for them. He kept trying to remind them when they were out there in that wilderness. He's like, but remember what God did. Remember what he keeps doing. Remember, remember, remember. He keeps trying to bring them on board, right? And you know who was sitting right beside him the whole time? Little Joshua. Little Joshua, son of Nun. He was sitting beside him the whole time. And he learned some things from Moses. In fact, when Moses would go into the temple and meet with the presence of the Lord, it says he would come out. He would actually meet with the Lord face to face, Moses would, and speak to him as though he was a friend. What an honor. And then Moses would return to camp, but his young aide, Joshua, son of Nun, did not leave the tent. Moses had given a legacy of the presence of God and the power of the presence of God to Joshua, so much so that Joshua's like, I don't even want to leave his presence. I don't want to leave his presence. You know who got to go into the promised land? Not Moses. You know why? All those grumbling people that he led. Isn't that sad? That's so sad to me that he didn't get to go because of the grumbles. But guess who got to go? That legacy that was left of seeking the presence of the Lord, Joshua, he took a hold of that. And he got to go in. And not only did he go in, he left a strong legacy. When God said to do something, he did it. He'd seen God do so much at the side of Moses and all these miracles, all these things. He knew God was his provider. He knew who his authority came from. And when God said, I want you to go to Jericho, and I would like you to march around one time a day, and then on the seventh day, I would like you to march seven times, and then don't say anything or make any noise until I tell you to. And when I do, and then when they did, what happened? Yeah, the walls came down. I hope that's the kind of legacy I'm leaving. That when our God says something to our children, that they will just do it and just be right there to see what he's going to do. That's what I want to leave behind. And I'm 45. I'm ready to go, Lord. But it is time to get on with some things that the Lord has called us to do so that we leave a legacy for our children like no one else could leave. If we don't, no one else will do it in this place. We need the presence of the Lord. We need his identity, his full identity, to be present in us. When I was the Lord is after your wholeness. He's after your wholeness. He sent his son, Jesus, to bring life more abundantly, and we've settled for just life. His thoughts toward us are good. And our grumbling and our complaining is generally it's a symptom of a misplaced hope. This is what the Lord revealed to me. Romans 15:13, this is key. You'll want to write this one down. Romans 15:13 says, may the God of all hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. So that, whenever you see so that, you can replace the word purpose. So that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So may the God of all hope fill you with all joy and peace. I could use a little joy and peace right now. Could y'all use a little joy? I could use some joy and peace. My mind and this world and all of these changes and nothing is settled. Nothing is settled. It keeps changing. That's really hard for us as human beings. We need certainty. We need to know what's coming. We need to know. And we don't have any certainty right now. We don't have any certainty out there in the world. But God is saying there's another way to have joy and peace. I don't need to be all comfortable and know what's happening. He's saying, I need to hope in him. If I hope in him, right, then he will fill me with all joy and hope, joy and peace as I trust in him. And so much so that I'm going to overflow hope on other people by the power of the Holy Spirit. I need people around me that are overflowing hope right now. Do you guys need that too? I feel like I need that so desperately. And the Lord showed me, we used to teach children in children's church that hope is like a rope. I know they rhyme, but it really does. Like the original use of the word tikva, if I'm saying that, I'm praying really badly pronouncing the Hebrew there. It means to stretch like a rope, the word hope in the Hebrew. And the definition is an expectation or something that we've yearned for and eagerly anticipated. And then the Greek version, the hope in the Greek is elpis. Oh, that's so much easier to say. And it means a confident expectation based on solid certainty. When I read that, my spirit just went, oh, thank you, Lord. I need a solid certainty right now. I need a solid certainty in my life. And if you're saying it's my hope in you, I'm just going to grab a hold of that. I'm going to grab a hold of that. This is what I'm going to say. I'm going to declare this over my life. God alone, he is who I put my hope in, right? God alone, I put my hope in God alone for my identity, right? My purpose, my value, my potential. I put my hope in God alone for my protection, my health, my safety, my security. I put my hope in God alone for my provision, my resources, and my opportunities. Can we say that? You guys want to say that tonight? We put our hope in who? God alone. There is no other solid certainty in the world or universe or cosmos. He is a solid certainty. He is our hope. And, you know, I know when I'm putting my hope in the wrong places because it starts to manifest really bad things. And, you know, when my hope becomes splintered, it's because I've put my hope in maybe my spouse. Oh, Adam, Bella, will you come help me? Where's Jack? Is he up here? Jack, can you help me? I got a children's ministry kind of illustration here. So if I put my hope in my spouse for all of those things, there you go. Go a little further away. There you go. Sorry. I don't know how long you need. All right. So if I put my hope in my spouse, right, that's not the right place to put my hope in. If I put, let's say Bella represents my church body or my church leadership, and I put my hope there. Jack, come here. And then I put my hope in my children. Like, you know, I'm a homeschooling mom. There's a lot of, like, pressure there, right? Like, if I don't do it right, they're not going to turn out right. And I can't blame anyone else, right? So they got to make me look good. You do struggle with that as a homeschooling mom. So, and they've done really well. Super proud of my kids. So, and my husband's amazing too. But if I put my hope in them, instead of tugging on this rope of hope with the Lord and pulling down the things of heaven that he has for me with it, you know what I do instead? I try to force my church body or my whoever maybe your employer or your employee, your job situation, or my children or my husband to be my hope, to be my identity, to be my value, to be my protection, my safety, my resources, my opportunity. And you know what I do when I tug on them? I move them out of their place where God has put them to be. I force them to be something God never intended them to be because I am not putting my hope where it belongs, right? I pull them out of that. I splinter my hope, and I don't only disturb myself, I disturb their purposes as well. I disturb that as well. All right, thank you guys so much. So this hope, this rope right here, this right here is the best thing I have to offer you tonight, and probably ever. This hope in the one true living God who wants to be our protection, our provision, our identity, this is the best thing we have to offer you as a church. This is the best thing you have to offer anyone. Really, this hope, this solid certainty, this hope is where you are going to find your joy and your peace that overflows by the power of the Holy Spirit. This hope and no other hope. You know, if I could do this, I can't because of social distancing and all that ridiculous pandemic that's going on. Lord, save us. I just want to place this in your hands. When you come in on a Saturday night or whatever we meet and you have a need and you have a struggle, I just want to place this in your hands and say, come alongside. Let's hope in God together. Let's hope in God together for whatever it is. It may be your protection. It may be your safety. It may be your job. It may be your value. It may be the potential that God has for you. Whatever it is that you need, have need of, there's a solid certainty in the hope of Jesus Christ. I just want to take your hand and put you on this rope and say, let's pull down what heaven has for you. Let's do that together. That's all I want to do. That's kind of like a mother thing in me. I just want to say, this is it. Let me help you, child. Let me put your hands where they belong. Let's say this together as in heaven as it is on earth. Let's pull down what God has for us, right? Let's pull it down. You know, the word says that, unfortunately, our tongue has a lot of authority over us. The things that we say, or we either speak life or we speak death over ourselves and others. In fact, James actually says that the tongue is like a rudder on a ship. The ship, no matter how big it is, that little rudder, it can just turn that thing any old way it wants to go. That's how our tongue is. If we speak the life over ourselves, we have life. We speak death. If we want things to move, we should speak to them and tell them to move. Right? By the power of the Holy Spirit. So, all that to say, there's a story, another story in the Bible about a prodigal son. And this story is the one all of us know about the father heart of God, right? That story is a really easy one to tell to get people to understand who God is as your father. And he says in that story, in that little parable in Luke 15:11, if you want to look it up, it says, the son, you know, he wanted his inheritance early. He went off and he squandered it to the point where he was destitute, ended up in a pig's pen, surviving off of scraps that the pigs were eating. Okay, so you can imagine, have anyone ever had pigs before? Or a neighbor or someone down the road? Because that's all it takes. And you can smell those guys way far away. Adam and I have a really funny story about that. You can ask us later. But pigs are stinky. And if he has destitute and he's laying in the squalor of the pig pen and he comes to his senses and the son says, oh my goodness, what am I doing here? My father's hired servants, they have more than I have right now. I'm going to go back and ask if I can be his servant. Maybe my father will let me be his servant. And he goes back, and his scripture says, while he was a long way off, his father saw him. He saw him. He greeted him. He put a robe around him. He put the ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, and he killed the fattened calf and they had a feast in celebration. He says, "For the son of mine was dead, and he's alive again. And he was lost, and now he's found." And so they began to celebrate. In this same chapter, there are two other small parables about a lost coin and another one. You should read them. Every single one of them is for the same point. The same point is this. There's rejoicing in heaven when one lost soul gets found or comes back to the Father. And I want to go a step further than that. I want to say there's rejoicing, and I believe this is true. There's rejoicing in heaven when your misplaced hope is restored where it goes. When your misplaced hope is restored, right? When it's restored, there's rejoicing in heaven. Those little things that we think aren't a big deal. We've been singing songs about strongholds. Strongholds are those places where we let the enemy in. We let the enemy in. And you know, I loved in this prodigal son story, the robe, he clothed him. He protected him. His body was probably ragged. His clothes were ragged. He was stinky. He put the ring on, which is identity. And he fed him, which was provision. That is the Father heart of God for his children. And those that come back, he has the same provision as those that have always been there, right? And in fact, the other son had a problem with it. He's like, "But you already have everything. Why do you care? Let's celebrate the one that came back." You know, I had to come back recently. I had to get rid of one of those black ropes where I had misplaced my hope. And that's why I'm giving this message. I'm not giving this to preach to you. I'm giving this because the Lord preached to me. And I know how powerful it was to get rid of one of those and reestablish where my hope comes from. The power in that is amazing, and it seemed like a small thing in my head until it was gone. And when I said, "God, I just don't want to deal with that anymore. I'm going to believe the best. I'm going to believe for everything you have for me." And it broke free. That stronghold was gone because I put my hope back in his authority over my life. You know, it's sad to say, but, you know, we all have strongholds, and there's no judgment there. It's the place where the Lord can work, where he wants to work for you. And I still have strongholds that I'm still working on the Lord with. And those things, they might seem small, but they're not small to him. He wants you to have wholeness. He wants you to have wholeness. He also wants us to have wholeness as a body. And as a body, the Lord gave me a picture. He said, you know, those strongholds, they don't seem very big. But when we come together as a corporate body, those little individual strongholds, they kind of tie your hands like those slaves. And they kind of make you build your enemy a city. I go, Lord, is a part of me sometimes working for my enemy? Building a stronghold to defeat me? And I'm letting it happen? When you have all this provision for me, what in the world am I doing? I love that he made me aware of that. And you know, I think we should be a people that's always sensitive to how he wants to grow us and change us. And if we're not, there's probably not a lot going on. If you're not growing and changing, we ought to be a people that still gets on our knees in repentance, even for small things. Not because we're so shame-filled, but because we serve a God who is so forgiving and so loving and has so much more for us. And if you, I don't think I've arrived yet. Anybody here arrived? Like you got it all, everything God got, he has for you. I have not arrived. I know I've not arrived. I know there's a hunger that is desired me. This is God, I just want to do more. I want to see more. I want to, wherever you want, whatever you want, I want to be in the center of your will for me. So tonight, I'm going to pray over you. I know, I'm done. Woo, good, okay. I'm going to pray because I believe that God said we should stake a claim in this place tonight. So let's bow our heads and close your eyes. Father God, I declare that with our hearts that we want all that you have for us in this place. We don't want to miss a thing. Lord, let us be found faithful. Oh, let us be found faithful. I declare that this is the Father's house. And as we come under his authority, we know we are his children, dearly, dearly loved children. And Lord, we give you full authority to work and move however you desire. Search our hearts tonight. Is there a place where I've misplaced my hope? Any place where I've believed a lie of the enemy? Any place where he is setting up a city with my slave mindset in that area, Lord God. We want to bring that down tonight. Lord, I call up hope that's been in hibernation. I call up hope that has been in hibernation. Father God, breathe life into our hopelessness and ignite our hope in you. God, we love you so much. We are nothing without you. Lord, I pray that tonight a flame was started that never goes out. That in this region, this place would be a resting place for you. That you would be pleased by your children in this place. That you would feel free to move and work in this place. And that, Lord, you would be glorified by everything that we say and do in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Can I have you guys stand up time? There's a sling in my voice, in a stone in my praise, pushing back when the darkest weapons form. There's a power on my lips, even death can defy, when the name of our God is lifted high. There is resurrection.
Amen, amen, amen. Amen. It's a long way to that stair over there to get up here. Be like Adam and just jump up here next time. Hey, before we end officially, I want to have Corey and Olivia come up. If Olivia's up for that. If not, just Corey, that's fine. Michelle, yes, bring Davey. It'll be fine. We'll try not to be loud. He's sleeping. Shh, everybody be quiet. So I wanted Corey to share, and we're gonna pray over them. He's getting ready to go on tour, a little skate tour. I'm letting him explain kind of what they're doing, and then we just want to bless him before he takes off.
Hey, guys. I'm Corey. Most of you guys know me. My wife is coming down with sweet Dave. He's been sleeping for a bit. I just want to share real quick of what I do besides just taking photos and those kind of things for ELM. Every year for the past 3 years, I do skateboarding tours throughout the United States. And the purpose of these tours is so that we can disciple the guys that go on the trip, and so we can share the gospel to skateboarders all throughout the United States. This year, we're actually going to be starting in Portland, Oregon. We're actually leaving. This is my wife, Olivia. She's the best. She's number one. And sweet Dave is even better. No, she created him, so she's better than him, I guess. But so we're gonna be starting in Portland, Oregon this year. We're heading off for it August 1st, so that's next week. And we're going there. We have 8 other guys that are gonna be in the midst of what we're doing and pouring into their lives. Having devotions every morning and having different guys in the skateboard community that love the Lord pouring into these guys, along with just sharing the gospel at skate parks and in the streets while we're skateboarding. And then we'll continue down the coast and in LA. And it's going to be a really, really amazing time. I've seen God do so many amazing things on these trips. I've seen kind of guys that came on the trip with a very small even knowledge of God and maybe not even considering them having a relationship with Christ, and then as the trip goes, having this life-changing experience where they say, man, you know, I used to think it was all my success, but now I found out that it's God's the one that's got me to these places, and God's the one that's given me the ability to do what I'm doing. And seeing their lives just completely transformed and to continue to change forever. So I just wanted to share a little bit about what we do and just kind of ask you guys to join with us and just in prayer and what we're doing. There's no way to do these things without the support of a community behind us. And, you know, these are crazy times. These are intense times. And I truly believe the Lord's called me to do these things. And I believe that if God's called me, just like what Michelle is speaking on, that he's going to make a way to make it happen. And I believe that's what he's called us to do. And so, yeah, if you guys could just partner with us, and just faith and in prayer that God will do amazing things, that he'll protect our guys on this trip, and he'll open every door that needs to be opened, and that, man, people will walk away from this trip saying, you know, skateboarding is really cool and all, but I know that I encountered Jesus on this trip. I know that I met God. And so, yeah.
Let's do that. Let's pray over him. We're just going to stretch your hands forward, if you would. And Father, we stand alongside both Corey and Olivia. Father, we stand with Corey as he goes. Father, love his heart that it would be easy to stay here. But Father, when you go on a trip like this, it is a trip of faith. It is a complete trust of your provision, of your leading. Father, it stretches faith. And so we ask that you would meet him where he is as he goes in into this next season. And Father, as he is gone, we ask that you would protect Olivia, Father, that you would guard her. I am believing that our body will not only support you in prayer, not only in support financially, but Father, that our body will support your wife here at home, that we will reach out, that we will check on her, that we will serve, and that we will meet the need. And as you go, Corey, that we stand in the gap for you, and that, Father, that we would help us love them well. Help us remember them, Father, that even if it's someone who says, I'm going to write their names in my planner, in my calendar, and I'm going to pray for them every day, and I'm going to see how I can meet their need. Father, that we would love them well, and we send them, we do, and we look forward to hearing, as Corey returns, the stories of how his faith has been stretched, how his faith has been increased. Father, that the salvations that will come to people that will come to know Jesus as their Savior. And not only that, but Father, that those that are going with him, these young people that are going in on this trip with him, that they don't even, you know, I just say, Lord, that they think they know what they're going into, getting into, but I just ask that you would blow their mind, that you would actually blow the lid off of anything that they could expect, and that you would go above and beyond, move in miraculous ways in front of them, with them, and behind them. And Father, show them just how you are leading and that you've given them ears to hear. Father, we do. We look forward to hearing the stories, and our hearts go with them, our prayers go with them, our grace and our love goes with them. And we ask that you just, like I said, guard Olivia. She stays here and keeps down the force. She takes care of Davey, takes care of the things that she needs to do. And Father, that the enemy, we block anything that the enemy would try to do to get in the midst of that. We ask for peace in the household and peace on the trip, safety, clarity, and vision. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Love you guys. All right. Hey, let's close out. Father, we just thank you for the word. Father, we thank you for time with you. Father, this is what I'm thankful for. We don't have to have big flashy lights, and we're in a place that can be intimidating. It's a presentation. It's a show place. It's all about the lights and the music and the atmosphere. And yet I'm all about your atmosphere. I'm thankful that we have a place that we can spread out and we can create a place that feels safe. And there is room. We have this whole building, Father. And I ask that if there is anybody that is hungry for corporate worship and they need a place that they can feel safe, that they can physically distance, we have this whole building, Lord. Bring them in and let us serve them, love them, and meet their needs. Father, that as we go, would you remind us that tomorrow you're going to have a question for us. You're going to call our name. You're going to reach out, and that we would remember to say, here I am. We wouldn't run. We wouldn't cower. We wouldn't be afraid. We wouldn't make excuses, but we would simply say, here I am. Father, we love you and we bless you, and your provision is beyond what we deserve and what we can fathom. And that for, I am so thankful. I am so thankful. We love you and we bless you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a great week. Go love someone well. And if you have any questions, reach out to me. And just, you know what, as you're leaving, remember, talk to each other, but leave some space.